بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sending men's greetings and salutations upon the final Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, we come unfortunately once again to this paganistic practice with these rituals that we're going to find in the following days. And thus it becomes appropriate for us Muslims to understand the khalfiyya, the background, or the historical elements, what these people claim or about to practice inside their lives. And unfortunately some Muslims as well who fail to understand the correct teaching of Islam or begin to find that there's no harm in sharing greetings and salutations and even some form of tacit approval of these paganistic rituals and practices on these days of kufr of these individuals. And thus we find that even according to their own sources of Wulan, that we find this is a great big fallacy about this belief of Christmas that we find. If you look inside the Encyclopedia Britannica Volume 3, that you find that the 25th of December is a day whereby you find that the pagans used to worship the sun. It is classified as a day of the invincible sun, because from that day onwards you find that the sun begins to return back to its full height, full measurement, that you find the days begin to lengthen once again. And the pagans, the Romans, they used to worship the sun. That you find all the way from centuries ago, when the Romans or the Christians entered amongst them, they began to adopt their teachings. Thus unfortunately you find a large portion of Christian teachings today is nothing but Roman pagans and rituals which have developed inside their belief today. And as you begin to study and read about these individuals, and this was the day that they used to worship the sun. Even you find this Christmas tree or the evergreen tree, that you find people in the northern hemisphere believe that this was a tree that would not die, that through the snow and the wind and the frost, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this tree to bear, to take these natural elements. But these individuals began to think that this tree possesses special powers. Thus they began to take branches of this tree and place it outside of their homes to protect themselves. Till eventually that you find that some of these individuals, they worship the tree, and those presents that you find placed underneath the tree today, they were actual gifts that they used to offer to the idols. Gifts that they used to offer to the idols, the essence of this. And even the Bible itself in the book of Jeremiah talks about those individuals who follow pagan rituals, who take the tree and deck it with gatherings or deck it with ornaments around it, and then they also begin to worship this tree. Even the Bible speaks out against this evil practice of these individuals. That as we as Muslims should begin to understand the historical elements of what these people are practicing inside their lives. Because indeed we find that many of these individuals, they don't really know what the teachings of Christ are. Or for many of these individuals today, it's just become materialism. It's a capitalist society. Those who don't know anything about Christianity or religion, for them, if you begin to study what begins to take place during these days, you find that more than £10 billion or dollars worth of wealth is spent over this period. £1 billion on unwanted gifts. The Sobhu had £1 billion worth of unwanted gifts have left there. An average family spends approximately £564. An average family on that day, on that blessed day of these individuals. Then they talk about poverty, the state of the economy, the state of the people. So these individuals are just a capitalist society. If it's not religion, it's just about enjoying themselves and wasting their money, another opportunity to spend their money. And the sad factor is only 14% of the people inside this country know who Jesus is or what's the teachings of Jesus. This is supposed to be a so-called Christian country. Most of them don't know who Jesus is or what the teachings of Jesus are. And that's quite sad and quite remarkable and a great opportunity for us individuals to begin to engage with these individuals, to begin to highlight to these individuals what are the teachings of Jesus. And as we as Muslims need to be reminded as well. Because many times when Christians will come to our doors and begin to preach and to tell us about Christianity, some of us begin to shy away, some of us don't know what to say. The answers are there. Inside the Quran spends a long effort and a long discussion through the Quran, Surah An-Nisa, the fourth chapter of the Quran, throughout that surah. Raddun ala al-Nasara wal-Yahud, the refutation of Christian beliefs and Jewish beliefs and practices that we find. Surah Al-Ma'idah, what's known as the table spread, begins to talk about their beliefs once again. Surah Al-An'am as well. Throughout the Quran you find it begins. Surah Al-Tahrim you find as well. All the way to Hatta Akhir Al-Quran, Surah Al-Ikhlas. Raddun ala al-Nasara. It's a refutation of these individuals. So the Quran spends a whole time focusing upon the belief of Ahlul Kitab, belief of these individuals, and trying to teach us what is the right belief. And as you find that the name Isa alayhi salam is mentioned some 25 times directly inside the Quran. And as you find when these people begin to highlight there's some form of animosity between us and these individuals. When you don't like the enemy, you don't praise the enemy. So the Quran goes out of its way, only mentions the name of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu salam 5 times directly. And the name of Isa is mentioned 25 times. For what purpose? If there's animosity, hatred between the Anbiya or between us and these individuals, you don't overpraise the enemy. But we know that Anbiya, دينهم واحد ولكن أمهاتهم شتى. The Anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all of them, their deen, their religion is one, their way of life is one. دينهم الإسلام. That's what they came with. ولكن أمهاتهم شتى. Their mothers are different. They came from different lands, different tribes, different languages possibly. But the message that they gave was all the same message. ولقد بعثنا في كل أمة رسولا أن يعبدوا الله واجتنبوا الطاغوت. We did send amongst every single people. Worship only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what every messenger came to tell his people. And to stay away from anything which is worshipped besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the teachings of Isa alayhi salam we find throughout the Quran. And the Quran begins to look at Surah Maryam, the 19th chapter of the Quran. All of us should go back over these days and begin to study this surah. Read this surah. Read it to see this surah. To help us have a better understanding of what our creed, what our belief is. And what these individuals attribute to Isa alayhi salam. Or far beyond that, what they attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And da'u lirrahmani walada. They attribute a son to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The debate about them isn't about color, isn't about dress, isn't about language. This is what they're attributing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And da'u lirrahmani walada. They attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman. They attribute a son to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inside Surah Maryam it mentions, the heavens and the earth are about to rip open. They're about to rip open with this evil statement of theirs, what they mentioned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's about to crumble down the heavens down upon the sky. But out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah prevents that to take place. But tasawwaru hadha, think about this. Imagine if somebody attributed something to your own mother or to your own father. And his expression goes, all hell would break out loose to defend the honor, the dignity of your mother and of your father. And think about this. وَلِلَّهِ مَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. What they attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What they say, subhana. Far beyond is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What they say about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has a son, or he has a daughter, or needs someone to help him. He is as-samad, the absolute, the eternal, the ever-living, who has no need of any of the khalq, has no need of any of the creation, or whatever he's created. Everything stands in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He needs no individual or anyone around him to protect or to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hatta al-Malaika, even the angels are serving their duty. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will destroy all of them at the end of time and raise them up once again. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is self-sufficient, the one and only subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you find if you begin to read inside Surah Ali Imran, the whole family of Imran that we find is talking about Maryam alayhi salam, and like her family inside Surah Maryam as well. How you begin to highlight the story of how Maryam, or before that her mother, many ulama tafsir have mentioned Hanna, the mother of Maryam, that she began to make this vow, this promise. She was hoping that a son will be born. And she said, I will dedicate my son into the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever inside my bottom, inside my stomach, when it comes out in delivery, I'm going to offer that in service to you, Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destined something else. لِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs to heavens and earth. يَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَاثًا وَيَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ الذُّكُورِ أَوْ يُزَوِّجُهُمْ ذُكْرَانًا وَإِنَاثًا وَيَجْعَلُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ عَقِيمًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to whomever He wants, He gives daughters to whomever He wants. And here you find أَسِّرْ فِي هَذِي الْآيَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned by firstly mentioning, gives to whomever He wants, daughters, إِنَاثًا. Praises daughters before He praises boys. Because we know that amongst those individuals, for amongst the Sha'a'i, the symbols, they should begin to boast about their children, especially about their sons. That you find Surah Al-Kawthar, that he is abtar. They should try to attribute to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, who are abtar, bima'na ma'indahu al-baneen. He doesn't have any sons to carry out his legacy, to carry out his message, to carry out his honor, his dignity. But the Quran mentions, who are abtar? That individual, his lineage is cut off. Because the rank and the privilege and the honor and the name of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam continues hatta yawmina hadha wa hatta yawm al-qiyama wa hatta fi yawm al-qiyama wa hatta ba'da yawm al-qiyama. His name will continue, the name of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Amma hadha shakhs, as for this individual, he's abta, he's been rejected, he's been taken away from all the blessings of this individual. So you find the mother of Maryam alayhi salam, she wanted this son, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala destined that she's going to have a baby child, a girl that she's going to have. فَلَمَّا وَدَعَتْهَا, when she gave birth, she dropped her load. She highlighted, this is a girl. وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى, and a woman is not like the girl. This is the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows the blessings, that there's a clear distinction between a girl and a boy. When these individuals try to push inside our society, that there is a concept of equality between men and women. Yes, there is equality. But at the same time, there is a clear distinction that Quran hints to, which is clearly visible to this day that you find, psychologically, biologically, that you find, spiritually as well that you find. There's a great big distinction between a man and a woman. Jihadul mar'a. What is the struggling of a woman? Is to perform physical jihad. Jihad wa al-hajj. Her jihad is to perform the hajj. Where the jihad of a man is something totally different. And like what you find other elements of spirituality. At times she has to pray, at times she doesn't have to pray, etc. All that's been lifted from her is a blessing for her. But read what the Christian theologians, what they write about the deliverance of a baby. They say that a girl, a woman, the essence of Hawa alayhi salam, because she trapped Adam, she made that initial mistake from eating or in tempting him to eat from the tree. Every single woman on the face of this earth carries that sin. هذه العقيدة النصرانية. This is their creed, their belief. Don't let their priests fool you. Go and read their works in great detail. For a long time, Christians were discussing whether a woman is to be classified as a human being. They used to destroy them. They used to burn them. They used to bury them. They used to sink them inside the river. That's what they used to do. Long discussion. Hatta to the 14th century, they began to discuss. Today, they are trying to push inside society that women should be priests and women should be like this and women should be like that. Go and read your tariq, your history. You never even recognize a woman as being a human being. And then you begin to blame us about the way we tell our women to dress, how they have their etiquettes, how they need to follow. The etiquettes that they follow are the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى. The man is not like the woman. They all both have their own separate roles. But Maryam alayhi salam, when she was born, وَإِنِّي سَمَّيْتُهَا مَرْيَمُ, I've given in the blessed name of Maryam alayhi salam. Look at the miracles. As you find the blessing that a daughter brings for a Muslim is something to be rejoicing, to be happy about. But you find once again in our culture, we begin to get upset about the blessing of a daughter or daughters being given to us. We get over worried about their marriage, about their life, and all these aspects that we find. This is a element of farah, of happiness for the Muslim, the individual, that she becomes even a greater source of nur, of light for that individual. And the love that she gives is different from the love that a son will give to the individual. And as you find that Maryam alayhi salam, the miracles were given, the blessings were given to her. كُلَّمَا دَخَلَ الْمِحْرَابِ, every time you find that Zakariya entered upon the mihrab, her station of prayer, وَجَدَ عِنْدَهَا رِزْقًا, he found food and provision being given to her. Food and provision out of season, out of weather. And he asked, Ya Maryam, أَنَّا لَكِ هَذَا, where did this come from? Where is this blessing come from? She highlighted, this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a great blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ, gives whomever he wants the blessings upon whomever he wants, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at Zakariya alayhi salam, who'd been trusted to look after Maryam alayhi salam. What happened to him? His iman increased. هُنَالِكَ دَعَى زَكَرِيَّ رَبَّهُ, Zakariya was barren. He had no children. When he saw the devotion of this young woman, this devoted individual, he then called out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He called out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I am aqeem, I have no children, I have no lineage, bless me with a child. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded to his call. So this is Maryam alayhi salam, the pristine beauty of this woman that we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought up. As the Quran begins to highlight about her, وَكَانَتْ مِنَ الْقَانِتِينَ, a devoted individual that she was, committed herself. وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرْ, when you find the angel came to give her the glad tidings, blew into her sleeve and said, you're going to have a child. Look at her words. وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرْ, she said, no man has ever touched me in their life. No man has ever come close to me. How am I going to conceive? How am I going to have a child? Look at even today how they depict Maryam alayhi salam, with a hijab, with a scarf, out of respect. Even though we know this is not Maryam alayhi salam, but they depict her in that manner, in a noble manner. Once again, this is a lesson for our Muslim sisters as well. They are recognizing that Maryam alayhi salam was a chaste woman. The most chaste woman that you can find is Maryam alayhi salam. Thus you find that even Jibreel entered upon her to speak to her. She said to him, stay away from me. In kunta taqiyya. If you're a pious individual, there's no need for you to speak to me, to have extra conversation, or to talk to me, or to mention anything to me. If you're a pious individual, stay away from me. But obviously, Jibreel alayhi salam wasn't a human being. And then he begins to give her the glad tidings. And then you find that Maryam alayhi salam, she carries the child. Ulama begin to debate about the essence. Walakin qawlu rajih, she carried it for 9 months. And she carried that child, you begin to find the difficulty of labor began to come upon her. And then she began to call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A woman, a strange woman, who's never had any relationship, who's never gone through childbirth, begins to call out, begins to highlight to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, begins to make this dua. قَالَتْ يَا لَيْتَنِي مِتُّ قَبْلَ هَذَا وَكُنْتُ نَسْيًا مَنْسِيًّا. She said, oh my Lord, if only been something forgotten, no one knew who I was. وَكُنْتُ نَسْيًا مَنْسِيًّا. And I become something who's forgotten by the whole of mankind. So she lost hope. But the Quran says, وَهُزِّي. Begins to hold fast to the rope, hold fast to the trunk of the tree, begin to shake the tree. You find rutuban janiyya, you find fresh dates will come down for you, and drink from the fresh water that be given to you. Ulama tafsir have mentioned that dates don't grow in December. Dates don't grow in December in the blessed land of Philistine. Dates grow in the month of March. So this is raddun ala nasara once again, whereby they believe that you find Isa was born in December. He wasn't born in December. Likewise you find, who said he was blonde haired, blue eyed? These were his features. People inside the land of Philistine very rarely have those features. But they want to infuse inside society that Jesus was a white individual. Jesus was this type of individual. For us, we don't care what color the Anbiya are, what type of individuals, or what their family, their lineage is. We know that all of mankind be created for one male and one female. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلًا لِتَعَارَفُوا إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَتْقَاكُمْ. We created nations and tribes to get to know one another. The most noble of you in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is atqaqum, the most pious individual. For us it makes no difference. Hatta you find the Wycliffe Commentary Bible, yuraddu alayhim, gives a refutation then that Jesus alayhi salam was not born inside December. Their own Bible, their own sources highlight, he was not born in December. It's not possible. So all of this is a great big fallacy of him being born in December, or him being the son of God, or him being this, or him being this. And that's the Quran begins to refute these individuals, highlight these individuals. Then you find the Qawl al-Yahud. Look at the way the Yahud they begin to behave. They begin to say about Maryam alayhi salam. What did they begin to say about her? That she had an illicit relationship with Yusuf al-Najjar, Yusuf the carpenter. That's what they highlight about her. Maryam alayhi salam, once again, she got worried. When she came, she carrying the child to the people. They began to say, your mother wasn't a bad woman. Your father wasn't a bad man. Your family weren't bad. And look at you. You've come with this. What could she do? فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. She just pointed to the baby. She could not say anything. What could she do? What could she respond? She pointed to the baby, pointed to the cradle. And what does the baby begin to say? قَالَ إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ. He says, I'm the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't say, أَنَا وَلَدُ اللَّهِ. Doesn't say, I'm the son of Allah. Doesn't say this. Doesn't talk about his mother. Doesn't talk about his community. He first highlights, I'm the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained upon me to offer the prayer, to give the zakah, and made me to become what? Kind and dutiful and bountiful to my mother, and not to be oppressive and to be good to my mother. Those are the words of Isa alayhi salam. And then this miracle silenced all of these people that this is a blessed individual, the teachings or the coming of the call of Isa alayhi salam. وَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِجَمِيعِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ.